All right, what's up, everybody? Welcome, welcome. Another episode of Toby's Tech Talk, a new year. We are in episode number 50, the big 50. So thank you all so much for all your support along the way. Really, really appreciate it. Of course, as always, I have a second monitor over here. So anytime you see me look over here, I'm just checking out the little notes. If anybody has any questions or anything, you can fire them into the question and answer section. That's why we do Toby's Tech Talk. That's why we have so much fun with it, because of all the live questions that come in. So if there's something bugging you throughout the month, if you have a question, go ahead and fire that in. Let's see here. Gil's saying he can't hear me. Hopefully you can hear me. Hopefully you can all hear me. It is coming through. So Eric, can you hear me? Everybody else hear me? Anybody else want to? Yep. All right. Cool. Thanks. All right. Excellent. All right. So welcome to Toby's Tech Talk episode 50. We're going to start out with our introduction. We're going to do a tech alert. We're going to talk about SOLIDWORKS and Prism news. We're going to talk about the monthly modeling contest. And then we're going to finish off with threads and lead-ins. Now, the tech tip that I try to come up with every month, it's usually derived from some type of question that I got in support throughout the month. This month, I got a question on how to create threads for a 3D printed or machined part. So if you're just working with a shop and they've already got the tap and die set up, they have the procedure all set up, you usually don't need to actually model the threads. But if you're going to be 3D printing a part, then it's a different story, and you are going to need to model the threads. And I'm happy to say that I've 3D printed parts with threads on them and had them engage properly. I even have created custom threads that have utilized just, you know, whatever dimensions I thought would work well, and you know, both the male and the female end, and had them work together, engage properly, and created working prototypes with threads. So it does work. It is a viable solution. But there are some things you can do to help ensure that that thread engagement is going to, you know, work a little better. And just in general, modeling threads and creating that sweep can be problematic because of the overlap that you get when you create a sweep thread. And I'm going to show you a good tip that you can use to resolve that. And then finally, the lead in to the thread and the lead out. The lead in at the one end, typically you'll create some type of a chamfer and lead in, but then when you get to the end of the thread, it just stops. And a lot of times users have questions on what the best way is to resolve that. In the old days, we would do that with a cut revolve, but nowadays we do it with a variable pitch helix. So I'm going to show you that as well during this episode of Toby's Tech Talk. But like I said, these questions are often derived from challenges that our customers are running into throughout the month as I'm working tech support. And I just kind of cherry-picked the ones I think would really give me a good example to use in Toby's Tech Talk. So I want you to remember that as we're going through today's episode, and feel free to fire in those questions in the question and answer block. We've got enough time today. I'm trying to schedule a little more free time in Toby's Tech Talk so that I'll either let you guys out a few minutes early, or I will be able to kind of deviate a little from the schedule and answer some of those questions on the fly. And of course, you can always email me as well. You know, after the tech talk is over, you could email me and say, hey, you know, I'm trying to create this. This would be a really good topic. And my coworkers are running into this too. You know, we know other people that are running into this challenge. Nobody ever really talks about this challenge. Kind of like last month, we did the twisted wire pairs. You know, I looked it up on YouTube before I did the webinar, and I only found one video where they showed how to create twisted wire pairs in SOLIDWORKS. And even that video was just video. There was no audio on it. So if you think of any questions along the way, feel free to fire them into the question and answer. But also, if you think of them throughout the month, feel free to send me an email. All right, so let's take a look here at our quick tip. Our quick tip is just going to be on customizing the S key. We are in a new version of the software, so we're going to customize the S key in this new version of the software. And as always, I like to launch a poll in the beginning. I've sort of already asked this question just through the question and answer block, but I just wanted to ask a question here to everybody. So if you look at your section for the poll, you're going to see there's going to be a question that shows up that says, can you hear me? So can you hear me? And I just want to ask you guys to take a moment to fill out that answer. All right. And we've got enough people voting saying that, yes, they can hear me, or I at least sound like I'm in a cave, but you can hear me. So, okay, good. I'm glad you guys can hear me. All right. Great. So, again, if you do have any questions along the way, feel free to fire those questions in to the question and answer block, and I'll be happy to answer them along the way. All right, so customizing the S key in SOLIDWORKS. You guys who have seen me for a while know that I love working with the S key, but I think it's worth it to just remind those of you who maybe are a little bit newer to the broadcast about the S key in SOLIDWORKS. This is SOLIDWORKS 2016. Do not adjust your monitors. It actually is meant to look this way with all these blue icons and blue and white everywhere. You know, when it comes to SOLIDWORKS 2016, there's not much you can do about the display. It looks, in my opinion, very washed out. I'm hoping that they're going to release a patch of some sort where they're going to allow us to go back to our old colors. I haven't heard anything from SOLIDWORKS that indicates that up to this point, but you know, that's something I'm hoping for. One thing you can do is you can go into options, and in options you can go to colors, and there's this section here, interface brightness, and adjusting that at least gives you a little more contrast, but you know, you can see here it's not really doing much as far as the issue of things being kind of washed out and blending together. So like I said, I'm hoping that SOLIDWORKS will address this. This was something that was considered an enhancement in SOLIDWORKS 2016, and it's meant to help people who suffer from color blindness or who have color blindness. Shouldn't say suffer. I hope that if you have color blindness, it's, you know, you're not suffering. But those who have it, it's supposed to help with bringing out the contrast of the icons. You know, like I said, hopefully it'll become an option instead of the only choice that we have. So what I wanted to show you here in SOLIDWORKS 2016 has to do with the S key. So the S key is just right here on your keyboard, the letter S on your keyboard. And what you do is you press that button S on your keyboard, and that little menu shows up. And that menu shows up in a number of different, in the four different modes that we have in SOLIDWORKS. So in SOLIDWORKS, we have parts, assemblies, drawings. Everybody knows about those. But the fourth mode is sketch mode. It's like an extra mode that you're in where only certain options are available. So when you're in SOLIDWORKS 2016, I noticed that the default S key, it kind of is shifted a little bit. Exit sketch used to be up here in this area, and now it's kind of shifted down. So I like to right mouse button and do customize. So the workflow for the S key, for those of you who haven't used it, would be something like this. I would maybe start a new part. So here I'm going to go new. I'm going to make a new part in millimeters. And then I'm going to come over here. I'm going to pick on my plane and then click the sketch command to begin the sketch. Then I'm going to come out on the screen and press the S key. And when I press the S key, I'm going to get this little menu here, and I'll choose rectangle and sketch my rectangle. And then I'll press the S key and I'll choose exit sketch. And then I'll press the S key again and I'll choose extrude and extrude that out into a block. And you can see here when I'm in feature mode, the S key looks a little different. So I can maybe press the S key and choose the fillet command, and then maybe pick this edge here, use this little shortcut to get the other corner edges. So you can see the S key is very handy. It's got a lot of good, useful commands that we get into in the software. But sometimes you want to, you know, you want to take it further. You want to work with more commands in that S key menu. And that's really what makes it powerful, is the ability to customize it. So some things that I do in SOLIDWORKS when I'm customizing the S key. Well, like I mentioned, I press the S key, and then I right mouse button here and choose customize right within the S key menu. And then I can take that and I can drag that around a little bit to resize it. So in SOLIDWORKS 2015, it looked more like this, where exit sketch was up here and then line was here. It's a subtle thing, but I think it's significant. You know, it's going to help that menu be more predictable for me. Another thing I just started doing recently is I started recognizing that the rectangle command, I really only use two rectangles from there. I use the corner rectangle and I use the center point rectangle. So I've started dragging the flyout menu for rectangle off, and then I go down here into sketch. And then once I get into sketch, I just bring in the regular corner rectangle command, and then I bring in the center point rectangle command. And so that saves me having to go into that flyout menu to get that center point rectangle. Wait, where's my center point rectangle? Is this another enhancement in 2016? It's just not here. Wow, okay. Well, this is something that I started doing in 2015. And, I guess it's this one. Center point rectangle. Oh, okay. The icon looks... Okay, I'm not going to... So I put that center point rectangle there, and I put the corner rectangle here like this. And that way I don't have to go into the flyout menu to get to that command. And then the other thing that I do is I put the point command on here on my S key toolbar, because I use a point command all the time. So I put the point command on there too. Now, depending what type of application or project I'm working on, I might also add the fit spline command. You know, I might remove some of these commands. Like, usually I don't get to offset from here, so I might remove offset from the S key. I'm just trying to make room for some of my other commands. So those other commands that I add onto there are the commands that come from features. So in features here, I add the feature extrude command and I add the cut extrude command. And again, you might need to reorganize these so that they land in the place where you want them or the place that's predictable. Again, this is the problem with these colors being so washed out. This is why I'm so surprised with SOLIDWORKS. In SOLIDWORKS 2015, it was really obvious where my feature commands were. They'd show up in this nice bright green and yellow. But in SOLIDWORKS 2016, everything is this blue and white color. And so it's kind of hard to tell where your feature commands are. So a little bit of rearrangement, you can kind of get it close to how it worked before, how it looked before. That's kind of what I would do with the S key to customize it. That's what I typically do with the S key to customize it. And this is something new that I started doing, adding the rectangle in the corner rectangle instead of having a flyout menu. So now my workflow is going to look like this. I'm going to press the S key, and then I'm going to use the corner rectangle and click here. I'm going to move my mouse out, and I'm going to move this over to 60 millimeters by 120. And then I'm going to press the S key again, and I'm going to choose extrude. And I want this to be a centered plate here, so I'm going to right mouse button in the background, and I'm going to choose midplane, and that way it's a centered plate. Now, if you look over on the left, you can see that the value for the depth of my extrusion is highlighted, so I'm going to type in 25, enter, enter. Now, again, to review that, what I'm doing by using these workflows or using this S key command is I'm avoiding a lot of mouse travel. So, again, if I wanted to make a centered plate here on the top plane, select the plane, begin a sketch, orient my view, S key, I click here, I move over, and I can immediately start typing in these dimensions. Now, this is a different option to immediately start typing in these dimensions. This was something that happened a number of releases ago. I think SOLIDWORKS 2013. 2012, it was actually added. 2013, it was improved. But it's here in options under the sketch command. So under the sketch command, we've got these options here. Enable on-screen numeric input. Let me just zoom in on the screen here. Enable on-screen numeric input and create dimension only when a value is entered. And so by having those two options turned on in sketch mode, that's how I'm getting those dimensions to just show up automatically. So I press S key now and I go to extrude. And again, I can either type in the value first or I can type in the value second, but then I can right click in the background and choose midplane and then right mouse button again to finish that command. So I never had to move over to the property manager for anything. I never had to move up here to touch any toolbars. All I had to do was get comfortable using the S key. Again, select a face, begin a sketch, orient my view, S key, sketch a circle here, move my mouse out, type in my value here, 35, enter, S key, extrude cut, and then I'm going to right mouse button in the background, and I'm going to say through all, and then I'm going to right mouse button again. Here I could click in the background in feature mode, and I can press S key and look at some of the commands I could get into. Center of mass. Okay, I could show the center of mass for this part. What a surprise. It's at 000. I would have never guessed. Right. I can S key here, and I can bring up my reference geometry command and turn on a mate reference or create a new plane or a new axis. I can S key here in the background and click fillet. And then I can single click on this first edge, and then I can click here to get all of the connected edges. Again, the value is already highlighted here, so if I wanted that to be something different, I can type in the new value and press enter, enter. But the point is that I'm not working on the model, then moving over to the property manager, working on the model, moving over to the property manager, working on the model, moving over to the property manager. So those are some things you can do if you use the S key and some of the other commands I mentioned there. You know, earlier this week, I taught a training class it's actually a training class that I wrote a book for. I've got the book here. SOLIDWORKS Advanced Tips and Tricks. Look at that handsome devil on the cover, right? Looks like I'm wearing the same shirt. So SOLIDWORKS Advanced Tips and Tricks. And in this book, we actually talk about a lot of those types of tips and tricks and workflows and things you can do to get through the software a lot more rapidly. So I'm kind of in that zone right now because I just taught the class. All right, we got some comments in the question and answer block. We got a couple of people here who both say they're colorblind and that they hate the new user interface. So there you go. That's some feedback there from people who actually are colorblind. Thank you guys for those comments. Always appreciate that kind of stuff in Toby's Tech Talk. Again, my name is Toby Schnaars. I'm here with Prism Engineering. I'm a tech support guy. Been doing it for a number of years. Have a bunch of different certifications and continue getting those certifications. In fact, this year, SOLIDWORKS introduced a new certification, the tech support. It's like a tech support onboarding certification, which is for new people who come to work at a reseller and need to get familiar with all the different processes involved in doing tech support and communicating with SOLIDWORKS headquarters. And I took that exam and I managed to pass it. So these past 15 years of doing tech support were not wasted. I am able to pass the onboarding exam. All right, SOLIDWORKS tech alert. One big tech alert I just wanted to share with you guys as far as SOLIDWORKS goes is that PDM standard is now part of SOLIDWORKS Professional. I just had a call earlier today where a customer was asking about what he can do to kind of prevent other people from editing files while he's working on them. He's got files on the server because he wants to share them. What can he do to prevent other people from working on them? So you guys are probably familiar or at least have heard of SOLIDWORKS Workgroup PDM. In fact, if you go to our YouTube page, so if you go to Prism Engineering YouTube, you can just Google that, Prism Engineering YouTube. It'll probably take you here. Here's our YouTube page. And on here, if you click on playlists, there's actually a playlist here on how to work with Workgroup PDM. So Workgroup PDM tutorial series, and you can look through that and learn all about what Workgroup PDM is. But Workgroup PDM is being end of lifed. It is being shelved. Workgroup PDM is going to be put on the shelf at the end of the SOLIDWORKS 2017 release. So what SOLIDWORKS is doing, or what SOLIDWORKS has done in the past, is they've bundled Workgroup PDM with SOLIDWORKS Professional, the middle level of SOLIDWORKS. And now SOLIDWORKS is bundling a new product called PDM Standard as part of SOLIDWORKS Professional. But what PDM Standard is it's really Enterprise PDM with some limitations. Enterprise PDM is being renamed to PDM Professional with full capabilities, and PDM Standard is being bundled with SOLIDWORKS Professional now. And this is a great solution if you're in the scenario that that gentleman was in this morning, where he's got SOLIDWORKS Professional. He never really got in and started working with Workgroup PDM, and so he's got the ability to install and work with PDM Standard, and all of his seats of PDM of SOLIDWORKS Professional will have access to that PDM Standard. So he can create different workflows, and he can create different folders where different users have got limited access. And that way, when he's working on something that's on the server, he's actually working on it from his SOLIDWORKS PDM vault, and the other users won't be able to access it, or they'll know that he's working on it. They'll only be able to open it with read-only access. And that's just one of many solutions that can be resolved with a good solid PDM system. But just keep in mind that if you have a SOLIDWORKS Professional, and you're looking for some type of a PDM solution, you've got PDM Standard, and you can start getting in and looking at that, and you're going to see a lot of webinars and a lot of news on that product throughout the year this year. We'll be doing a lot of those webinars too. Another thing that's come up a couple of times this month in tech support, I just wanted to let you guys know, if it seems like SOLIDWORKS all of a sudden won't launch, you can do a search for this KB3097877. Again, it just kind of rolls off the tongue like some of the KBs we were talking about last month. I did mention this last month as well, though. So you're working away, and as you're working away, you get a Windows update. You shut down your computer the other day and Windows runs all those updates. And then all of a sudden SOLIDWORKS won't launch anymore. This could be the culprit. This has been around for a little while, so I'm going to take this slide off next month. But I just wanted to mention it one more time that it could be a Windows update that's the culprit there. And if you just jot down this number, when you go into programs and features, you can search for that update. Some questions here. A couple questions about PDM. Is our class offered on PDM at Prism? Absolutely. We offer a lot of classes, everything from kind of a stock, just this is how you do PDM and do the install, all the way up to, on-site at your company implementation and then training your users. So we offer the full gambit. You can just send me an email afterwards, Eric, and I can get you in touch with the right people to help coordinate that. Can you import current PDMW vault? How do you handle current vault? This is a great question, Joe, and here's the answer to it in short. Workgroup PDM has an upgrade utility that goes to Enterprise PDM. And that upgrade utility works fairly consistently as far as compatibility. It's not often that you're going to find that a Workgroup PDM vault can't be upgraded and migrated into Enterprise PDM. The SOLIDWORKS PDM standard, which is, I'm going to say it's Enterprise Lite. It's kind of a good way to think of it. You've got PDM Professional, which is Enterprise, and then you've got PDM Standard, which is kind of like Enterprise Lite, has some limitations on how many workflows you can create. And because of those limitations on the number of workflows you can create, if your Workgroup PDM vault had life cycling, then it's possible that you will run into a limitation when you attempt to migrate it into PDM Standard. And if that's the case, then PDM Professional would be the solution for you. So it depends on the company's vault and how many life cycles and how they've got their life cycles and their revision scheme configured. The short answer is, yeah, it absolutely can migrate into PDM standard. But the caveat to that is, provided you've got a pretty basic revision scheme. You got a pretty, you know, you don't have any life cycle and you've got one single revision level, I don't see any problem migrating that into PDM standard. But as you add on more revision schemes and as you add on more life cycling from workgroup, it's possible you'll run into a limitation where PDM standard won't be a possibility because of the fact that PDM standard is a limited version of PDM professional. I hope that clears it up, clears up the answer to that. There's going to be more information on that. I'm going to be beating up this topic a lot. I've talked to you guys before about it. I'm working on a PDM standard vault on a different machine on a laptop, just kind of testing it and becoming acclimated with PDM professional and PDM standard. My next step is going to be to install that on this machine that I'm working on right now and actually try to migrate my own vault into it. And then I will hopefully be able to answer those questions with more clarity. Like, yeah, it'll work if you have one life cycle or zero life cycles, but it won't work if you have two or more. You know, or that's not an actual limitation. That's just, I'm just giving you an example of how I'll be able to further elaborate on that process. Great questions there on PDM. Some other news from SOLIDWORKS, SP5 came out. This came out before the end of last month, but that's good to know if you're working with SOLIDWORKS, if you're working with SOLIDWORKS 2015. And again, remember, you can go to our website, the Prism Engineering YouTube page, or you can go to our YouTube page. And on our YouTube page, we've got some videos on some of these topics of upgrading. There's a video on here about upgrading to
Toby Schnaars.
Upgrading to or doing the full download of SOLIDWORKS 2016. Of course, this would pertain to 2015, 14, 13 as well, all the ones that are on the SOLIDWORKS website. And then also there's a video on there about upgrading your SOLIDWORKS network license. So if you use shared licenses or floating licenses, there's a video that explains what you have to do. If you do use network licenses, you just got to remember you have to download and install the new network license manager, and then you also have to activate. And when you activate, that'll grab your new licenses from SOLIDWORKS. So it's actually two steps involved. If you're working on the same server. And SOLIDWORKS 2016 SP1 also came out since we met last time, December 10th. SP1 is out. I downloaded it. You can do the full download of SOLIDWORKS. Like I said, there's a video on that. We also have a PDF we can share with you. It's 10.4 gig, the full download. The nice thing about the full download is you don't have to have, you know, you don't have to work with the two separate DVDs. A lot of times we get questions in tech support like, what do I use a second DVD for? Where's the network license manager? If you have the full download, you don't have to worry about any of that. So we recommend always working with that full download. These are our recommendations if you're getting a new computer. We talked about this last month. I talk about this every month. I'm going to skip that slide for now. And where do you find more news about SOLIDWORKS? A great resource here is right inside the SOLIDWORKS customer portal. So you go to SOLIDWORKS.com and we go log in. And we say SOLIDWORKS customer portal. So here I am at SOLIDWORKS.com, customer portal. I'm going to log into the SOLIDWORKS customer portal. And then over here on the right, what you're going to see over here on the right is you're going to see some information regarding SOLIDWORKS news. And over here, you're also going to see some information regarding popular solutions. So, you know, again, just keep that in mind. That's another really good resource. Another resource that I didn't mention much in 2015, and I want to try to make a point of mentioning it a little more now, is a website called my.solidworks.com, my.solidworks.com. And when you go to my.solidworks.com, you can see here, it says your place for all things SOLIDWORKS. This is kind of like an aggregate of SOLIDWORKS solutions, like knowledge-based type solutions, SOLIDWORKS forums, where you can communicate with other users, models, where you can go online and you can actually download models, kind of like GrabCAD or 3D Content Central, and SOLIDWORKS tutorials. So it's one aggregate of all those things. So if you did a search here for sheet metal, you're going to get hits on, you know, from all those different locations. SOLIDWORKS online help here, you know, giving you some tips on sheet metal from the online help, and some models here for sheet metal from 3D Content Central. And, you know, just some other things here. You'll see some forums we'll land on here as well. Here's some information from the forums. So just that one single search grabbed from all those different locations all in one shot. So you can check out my.solidworks.com as well for some SOLIDWORKS news. Prism Engineering news and events. You hit our website, www.prismeng.com. It's a great place to go. if you're bored at work, right, you could look at Google News, or you could go to www.prismeng.com. And so you can see here, if you go to prismeng.com, up at the top here, you've got events. And you can see all the upcoming Prism Engineering events. Wow, this is a big image here. I don't know what's going on with this. Machine Shop Productivity Day. Yes. So there's looks like there's a seminar here, Machine Shop Productivity Day. Here we go, all the other live events. I'll have to make sure I let Sean know about that. But all of our events are posted on here, so you can always come in here and check it out. You can see an upcoming webinar tomorrow on SOLIDWORKS electrical design, harness design with SOLIDWORKS electrical. So all free events almost always free events, always free webinars. So you can check us out at the Prism Engineering website under events. And the other thing you can do at the Prism Engineering website is you can hold your mouse over the word support. And then you can go down here to remote support. And this is how you get to our virtual tech session, our remote desktop session. So if you call up for SOLIDWORKS support and we say, can we do a screen sharing session? You can say, yeah. And I know exactly how to get there because I was in Toby's Tech Talk this month. You hold your mouse over support and you go to remote support. And then we'll give you a code and you enter in this code here. And then that'll start the screen sharing session. And of course, the other some other events that we've got here was yesterday. Heather and Aaron had their inaugural launch of their Straight From Support. Heather and Aaron explained some of the most commonly dealt with SOLIDWORKS questions that have come through the tech line. So again, kind of in the same vein of Toby's Tech Talk and the tips that we show here, you know, what are the most common issues that came up this month in support? And that's going to be a new monthly series with Heather and Aaron. So you get a chance to see some more faces from Prism Engineering and kind of meet a little bit more of the team and find out what some of the most common questions are that we're getting in tech support throughout the month. Another announcement here for news from Prism. I'm on Twitter, right? I'm the person who posts the least amount of posts on Twitter in the entire world, okay, who has an account. I'm the person who has an account but posts the least amount of posts. So, will try to be more active about that this year. But I always say that, right, Mark? Mark knows that I am always all over my Twitter feed there. Users groups. I love the users groups. These are all active users groups here. The Marisug users group, the Lehigh Valley users group, the Eastern Shore users group, and the South Central New Jersey users group. Okay, and I want to thank everybody. I had about five or six people who submitted ornaments. I'm still going to get them on the tree here, and we'll take a look at what those ornaments look like next month. But thank you guys who submitted those from last month, the Toby's Tech Talk contest. If you didn't submit one and you want to take a look at what we're talking about, just look back at the YouTube page. We do post all of Toby's Tech Talks on the YouTube page. And we're going to get into the monthly modeling contest next, but I just wanted to mention one more thing here, which is that next week is, I think it's next week, is SOLIDWORKS World. So if we go here to SOLIDWORKS World, just a Google search, we can see here's the SOLIDWORKS World website. And the SOLIDWORKS World event is a great event if you can attend. But the other thing that's cool, okay, it's not next week, I'm sorry, it's in a couple of weeks. But the other thing that's cool about the SOLIDWORKS World event is that the presentations are all recorded and posted. So you guys who aren't able to attend are still going to get this terrific influx of resources, because after the SOLIDWORKS World event is complete, you're going to be able to watch all the videos that people the sessions that people did at SOLIDWORKS World. So be sure to check that out. It's really good stuff there, the SOLIDWORKS World results after the presentations are all done. Really cool. If you can go, it's in Dallas, Texas, but even if you can't go, this is one of my favorite times of year, even when I don't go, because I get to go and look at all those terrific presentations, like Phil Sluder's Tips and Tricks always has, you know, standing room only attendance. It's a great one to look at. And what I'll do this year is I'll look through some of them and I'll post, or I'll let you guys know kind of the ones that I think are the better ones. That way you guys can take advantage of that too without having to filter through every single presentation. All right, so this month, the modeling contest, I wanted to challenge you guys a little bit more. Last year, it was good. We kind of had a great year. Everybody was able to participate throughout the year. This month, I'm going to challenge you a little bit more with these modeling contest ones. So we're going to get the ball started here with this double-threaded 3D print here. So I'm going to open up a PDF here. This PDF has three pages. So what you can do here with this PDF is you can choose print screen, which is a button on your keyboard. And when you choose print screen, you can then go into Microsoft Paint and you can press Control V, and that's going to paste this down. So you can see here over on the right, the material is ABS-PC. The density is 0.039 pounds per cubic inches. And what is the mass of this part in x.xxx pounds. Send your answers via email, subject TTT-050, address tschnaars@prismeng.com. So you can see here the print for this part. You can see that the thread has a lead-in at the one side. You can see that the part is centerline symmetric. So because of that, the thread is left-handed on the one side, it's right-handed on the other. So this would be an example of a 3D printed part that we need to actually model the thread for. Now I'm going to show you another page here. So if you pasted that into Paint, get ready for another page here. So this is what the thread profile looks like. Giving you guys a little bit of guidance on this one. Without some of this info, it would be pretty impossible, almost impossible to have consistency in the answers. So this is what the thread profile looks like. So again, if you hit print screen, you can print screen that, and then you can put that into another instance of Paint. So you can hit print screen, then go into Paint, and you can press Control V. There's some other ways you can do screen captures too, but that's a valid way, a brute force way, if you will. And then this slide here, this is the helix parameters that I used for this thing. So this is going to be something that's also going to be important for you, so you can understand what's going on in the lead out region, in that lead out region. So if you do this contest every month, you know that it's kind of twofold. I want it to be a contest because I like the participation, but really what I like is I like giving you guys the ability to investigate, experiment with new areas of the software that you maybe haven't had a chance to experiment with before, like creating a sweep cut of a helix, working with a variable pitch helix, things like that. So I'm going to show you guys some tips on how you can create that type of geometry. But again, I just wanted you to have a chance. I'm just going to go through all three pages one more time in case you didn't have a chance to get them all. Here's page one. You can hit print screen. You can launch a session of Microsoft Paint and press Control V. Paste that down. Here's page two. You can press print screen. You can launch a session of Microsoft Paint and you can paste that down. And then obviously, you'd save that off as a JPEG or a PNG file. And then here's sheet three. I know that the resolution of that screen capture is a little bit funky. There's nothing tricky going on in there. It's 1.5, 1.75, 0.125, 1.25, and 1. Those are the only numbers through. Oh, and 0. So it's... and 12 and 14. So there's no trick numbers in there. They're all nice round numbers. Nothing is in a smaller increment than an eighth of an inch, and the rest of the numbers are all in quarter inch increments. So if it looks a little funky, just kind of use your best judgment, best call on that. But there's nothing, it's not like there's a 7 in there or anything. There's a 1.75, but they're all, nice, sharp, crisp numbers. Okay. So with that, let's take a look at the SOLIDWORKS demo here. It's not mate reference, it's on threads. That was from last month, sorry about that. Okay, and so the challenge here is creating threads, threads and bolts, all right, for 3D printing or for manufacturing. And the challenge that we run into is typically in this area here at the top of the screen. And at this area here at the top of the screen, there's a lead-in for that thread. And then in this area here on the bolt on the left, there's often a lead-out as well. And that's kind of the challenge that we run into when we're trying to create a bolt that's going to be 3D printed. Now, in SOLIDWORKS 2016, this issue actually has been addressed with the ability to create threads. So if I was to create a hex here, and I'll just put a quick dimension on this. And then I'm going to extrude that. So S key extrude. And then I'm going to select this face and begin a sketch. I'm going to sketch a circle. I'm going to make that 0.25. And I'm going to do S key extrude. And I'm going to bring that out to 1 inch. What we can do in SOLIDWORKS 2016 is we can use the command insert features thread. This is a new feature in SOLIDWORKS 2016. And so I can pick this edge here and I can indicate that I want to be working with a thread here. I could say maybe this is going to be quarter 20. Okay, and then this is going to be a thread. This is going to be a cut thread. And that cut thread is going to be for a tap. So in SOLIDWORKS 2016, you can do it by just using that new command, a nice new command. All right, but in SOLIDWORKS 2015, 14, 13, that functionality wasn't available. So what I wanted to do was I wanted to show you guys kind of how I would approach something like that. And also there's some good tips and tricks in here just kind of on general best practices. So we go top plane, begin a sketch, orient the view. I'm going to use my hex again, just like we did before. I'm going to give this thing a dimension. And again, this is for some type of a custom 3D printed part. So, you know, if it's a quarter 20 and you've got a quarter 20 nut around, you can test it as soon as you 3D print it. But of course, the head style, you know, it doesn't matter. It doesn't have to be per the machinist handbook or anything. The thread style does, but the head itself, you know, can be whatever size you think is going to look good and whatever style you think is going to look good. So if you wanted to put some type of a round, you know, on the outside, you know, you absolutely have the ability to do that. So if I was going to go here and say that I want this to be, you know, a certain height, so let's say make it a quarter inch again, just like we did last time. And then we can go here to our, circle sketch. So select a face, begin a sketch, orient the view, press the S key, type in our radius or our diameter, extrude that up. Let's say we make that 2 inches this time. And now we're ready to start actually making our thread. So like I said, the two challenges here are the lead in and the lead out at the bottom. So for the lead in, you have a couple of options, but the what I like to do with the lead in is I like to make a plane that's offset just some nominal amount from the thread. So let's say I wanted there to be 1 inch worth of quarter 20 threads on this thing. So what I could do for that lead in is I could take this plate, this surface here, and then I could do S key reference geometry plane, and I can make a new plane that's some nominal distance off from there. So let's say that nominal distance is 0.5, it's half an inch off from there. That way it's nice and easy for me to calculate, you know, the appropriate depth into this thing. So if this is supposed to go 1 inch in, then I'm going to want to make sure that my helix is 1.5 inches. Now, another thing to consider when you're generating threads or working with threads is that sometimes the thread diameter, the actual OD is slightly smaller than what the nominal or the basic diameter is. And you can look up that type of information in Machinist Handbook. So if I did a quarter 20, UNC thread dimensions on Google. You know, let's see if I can get some information on this. Okay, so sometimes that'll be listed here as sometimes it's listed as pitch diameter. Sometimes it's listed here as like a basic effective diameter in inches. And basically what you're saying here is that you don't want your threads to come all the way out to the actual 0.25. You want them to be kind of capped off or flattened off a little bit. So if we were going to go with, you know, with this number, but this number here is actually your pitch diameter. But if we were going to make that a little bit smaller, and again, if you're 3D printing, you could do this as an experimentation. We might do that with some type of a cut extrude. Just to create that region. So it's something to consider. I'm not gonna do that for this example here, but it's just something you want to kind of keep in mind as you're working with your thread. Sometimes you actually cap it off a little bit lower, and you're gonna want to incorporate that into your design as well. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to create the actual helix here up at this location. So I'm gonna pick this face here, and I'm gonna begin a sketch, the plane. And then I'm going to take this face here and I'm going to do a convert entities. And once I do that convert entities, what I'm doing is I'm just taking this circle here and I'm tracing it up to that location. And again, if we had made this a little bit smaller in order to accommodate that, you know, the fact that you don't really want this to go all the way out to 0.25. So let's say you made it like 0.24, just take 10 thou off of it, or 0.235. Just take a little bit off of there for that thread. And then we extrude that down. Then, see what happened there? I cut that in and I just made it into a sleeve. What I wanted to do there was I wanted to say that I want that to go down 1 inch deep. And then you can use this command here, flip side to cut. So cut everything that's on the outside instead of cutting everything that's on the inside 1 inch deep. And of course, here this looks kind of like a stop sign. I would go to options and I would go to document properties, image quality, and just drive that up a little bit. This is something that's set in your template. So there we go. Now it looks a little bit cleaner. So then if I was to select this face here and begin a sketch and pick this face here and convert it, then obviously I would get that smaller circle for my helix. Okay, so that's kind of what the process would look like if you were going with that smaller one. So now that I've got that circle there, I'm ready to create my helix. So I could click that circle there and I could create my helix. So I could go features and then I could go curves, helix, and spiral. And you can do this from right within the sketch. So if I was in this sketch here and I picked this face and I did a convert entities, and I was to convert that face onto this plane here, then what I could do is I could go features, curves, helix, and spiral and jump right into that command. So now for my pitch is going to be 1/20, right? Because it's a quarter 20. And then I'm going to set my defined by here to height and pitch. And then for my height here, my height is going to be 1.5. Because it's going to be 1 inch plus the extra half an inch for that plane that's out there. And then I'm going to say reverse direction. So it's going down into the model. And there we go. We got ourselves a sweep path. Now, the other thing you can define when you're working with that helix here is you can say edit feature and you can say where the start angle is. So I can make the start angle 0 or I can make the start angle 90 or 120. It doesn't really matter what your start angle is. And you're going to see why in just a moment. So we're going to create that thread and then that thread is going to sweep down here. When we pick on this edge here, we're going to create a chamfer and we're going to use that chamfer for the lead in. So we're going to create this chamfer here, and let's say we make that chamfer 20 thou. You know, now we could maybe call out a diameter here. Like this diameter is 0.210 at this point, and maybe we could call out an angle dimension, make that angle 45 degrees. So we've got our chamfer dimension of 0.020, and we might call out this dimension here, this diameter here, as a lead-in diameter for our thread. You know, of course, if that was a little bit larger, like if I made that 0.025, you know, then our lead-in diameter would obviously be a little bit smaller. Okay, so our lead-in diameter there is 0.2, and then our angle on that is 45 degrees. Now, one of the most common mistakes I see people make when they're working with threads is they forget about what I consider the basic rule of sweeps. And one of the basic rules of sweeps is that you always want your sweep profile to be perpendicular to your sweep path. So you've got your sweep path coming over and down. You want your profile to be perpendicular to your path, always perpendicular to your path. And that's something I talk about a lot in the YouTube videos on creating sweeps. There's a number of videos on YouTube about how to create sweeps that I've posted on the Prism Engineering page. With a helix, it's often overlooked because it's such a subtle difference, right? If I look at this thing from the right plane, okay, I started my helix at 90 degrees. So right plane is, you know, it's right there, right at the start of that thing. There it is, 90 degrees, perfect. So I just click on my right plane and begin a sketch. But that helix is really coming up at an angle. So if I was to press the S key and go reference geometry plane, I'm going to pick that helix and then pick the endpoint. And that's going to make a new plane perpendicular to the curve at the endpoint. And if we compare that new plane to the right plane, we see that no, they're not right on top of one another. It actually is at an angle. And that's important because this is going to help guarantee that your thread is uniform throughout, that's not leaning throughout, and that you're going to get better engagement with the other part. Now, again, if you're 3D printing, does that 5 degrees or 10 degrees really make that big a difference? It depends. It depends on what kind of 3D printer it is. It depends on if you're also 3D printing the female part. You know, but yeah, it absolutely could make a difference. And more importantly, it's a best practice. You want to always get in the habit of working with your best practices. Now, another challenge that people run into when they're working with a sweep of a helix, a sweep of a thread or a sweep of a helix, occurs in this region here, where the sweep profile comes and touches the body. And what happens sometimes is you end up with a little sliver edge. You end up with a little, like it doesn't quite cut in all the way. And I'm sure those of you who have done sweeps of threads before have run into this. It doesn't quite cut in all the way. So I'm gonna show you how I address that now as well. So we're gonna go here to our new plane that we've created. New plane, we're gonna click that plane, we're gonna begin a sketch, we're gonna orient our view. And we're going to draw a line here, a center line that comes up from our origin. Nice vertical center line there coming up from the origin to the vertical sketch relationship on it. And then what we're going to do is we're going to draw our thread. And whenever I draw threads, they always look the same way. They look like this. Now, I'm exaggerating here, but it's because I want you to make, I want to make sure you guys can see where I'm going with this. So I go midpoint to midpoint, and then I take that line and I make it horizontal. And then I sketch a vertical line here. Just turn on my sketch relationship so you guys can see all the relationships. And then I sketch a point here at the intersection of those two. Point. And what I do here is I take this point and I use the pierce constraint to pierce that point to my sweep path. And then what I do is I give myself about 5 thou extra of meat here. Now, it depends on the size of the thread. You know, if the thread is larger or smaller, it might warrant larger or smaller diameter there. But that's what I do for my thread to create the geometry so that it properly overlaps a little bit when I'm creating. You don't want to go too much, because if you go too much, it'll overlap with the existing sweep, and I'll show you what that looks like in a minute. But then what I do is I take my thread diameter here, okay, and my thread diameter here at the inside is going to be 0.2062. So there's my thread diameter at the inside. I give myself my angle dimension here. That's going to be 60. This is, let's see here, I have these midpoint, midpoint, horizontal. So this is basically behaving already as a symmetric, so I don't have to add symmetry there. And so now the final thing that I need to add in here is either the width at the bottom or the width at the top, depending on what type of thread it is and whether or not you know it. So this is going to be 1/8 of 1/20. I think it's what the typical formula is. So so you know, in SOLIDWORKS, I could do like 1/20, and then I could do 1/8 of that. Okay, so now I've got my my overlap here. And, you know, again, looking at this, this is 0.006. So maybe this 0.005 here is a little too much. Maybe I want that to be like 0.002. And you'll see why here in just a minute. So now I'm going to exit that sketch, and then I'm going to perform a sweep cut command. So features, swept cut, and I'm going to sweep this profile along this path. And what's nice is that because I know that the because I know that the profile is perpendicular to the path, I can be confident that that profile is going to remain true throughout the sweep. Now, when we're examining the preview and we look in this region here, we can see the phenomenon that I was warning about before. You could imagine that if I had sketched this right on the helix, pierced right to the helix, that I might end up with a little sliver here. Might end up with a little sliver here where the sweep just doesn't quite go all the way through properly. So that's why I put in that extra little amount of meat, so that when I perform that sweep cut, I end up with the desired results. I think that in my profile, I went a little too small on that 0.006. So let's make that a little bit larger. I have to double check my math there. So now what we've got is we've got our lead in for that thread. You can see that by putting that chamfer on there, we're giving ourselves the ability for that thread to begin to properly engage. So for the lead in, it's pretty straightforward. You can just give yourself that chamfer. But what about for the lead out? What about for down at the bottom here? Well, SOLIDWORKS gives us the ability to work with what's called a variable pitch helix. And with a variable pitch helix, what you do is you start out your helix just the way that we did a moment ago. I'm going to say 50 millimeters, and I'm going to say that I want this to be a curve, helix, and spiral. And you can see here what I'm doing with that 50 millimeter. Let's say I want that pitch to be 5 millimeters, and I want the overall height here to be 40 millimeters. Well, with a variable pitch helix, what you're able to do is you're able to say, I want to work with a table. And from the height of 0 millimeters to the height of 10 millimeters, I want the diameter to be 50. Then from the height of 10 millimeters to the height of 15 millimeters, I want the pitch to still be 5, but I want the diameter to increase to 75 millimeters. So pitch is still 5 here, but diameter is going to increase to 75 millimeters. And so you can see it growing here. And then from 15 millimeters to 25 millimeters, I want the pitch to remain at 5, and I want the diameter to be 75 millimeters. And then from 25 millimeters to 30 millimeters, I want the pitch to be 5, and I want it to taper back down to 50 millimeters in diameter. And then finally, from 30 millimeters to 40 millimeters, I want the pitch to be 5, and I want the diameter to remain at 50 millimeters. And so when we examine this helix spiral, you can see that we get a result like this. And we can use that same technique to generate the lead out for a thread in our 3D printed part. So here, if I go back earlier in the tree and I find my helix spiral, you can see that I'm defining this helix spiral as a constant pitch. But I'm going to change that to a variable pitch. And with a variable pitch, I'm going to say from a height of 0 to a height of 1.5, because I want this to be 1 inch deep. So from a height of 0 to a height of 1.5, I'm going to utilize the pitch of 0.05, and I'm going to utilize a diameter of 25. And then from a height of 1.5 to a height of 1.75, the pitch is going to remain 0.5, but the diameter is going to increase to, say, 0.375. And so if we look at that, preview, we can see what the result is. And if we hit the green check mark, we can see that now SOLIDWORKS is tapering that thread outward and generating our lead out for that thread, which is going to help with the machining process. It's going to look more aesthetically pleasing. It's going to behave more like a real thread, where as it gets down to the bottom, it almost behaves like a pipe thread, where that diameter is increasing, so it starts to tense up at the bottom. So all of your all benefits to working with that variable pitch helix. So again, remember, when you go into the variable pitch helix, you are presented with a table. I find the easiest one to work with is height, height and pitch. For the variable pitch, you've got your height, pitch, and diameter, all driven values, and then your number of revolutions is driven. I find that one to be the most intuitive, but you can work with other ones in there too. But I find height and pitch to be the most intuitive. You just type in the height you want, and then and that's your total height from the start, not your, you know, your new height. I think that's what kind of gets confusing about revolutions is it stacks them instead of being the total. So that's a technique that you can use to generate that lead out. You know, again, if this is a 3D printed part, you can maybe do a little experimentation. Maybe 3.75 is a little too high for that diameter. Maybe the lead out, you know, maybe it's taking too long to get there for that tapering. So if I made this 1.625, you can see that the results are going to be a little bit different. It's gonna immediately go out. Or if I maybe made this 2 inches. Now that taper out is going to span over a larger number of revolutions because it's gradually growing out to that new defined pitch or diameter, excuse me. So that pretty much brings us up to the 1 o'clock hour. As always, I want to thank you guys for tuning in. I hope that demystifies that process of creating threads. I hope that you can use that. If you want to challenge yourself and do a little bit more with this, you can, again, take a look at this challenge, this Toby's Tech Talk challenge. And you can attempt to create a part like this. Now, this would be a part where you're creating some type of a custom double thread for a 3D printed part. You got a 3D printed mechanism, you want to test it, you want to manufacture it, you want to have it actually properly manufactured eventually, but right now you just need to test it. It doesn't need to stand up to 1,000 uses, it needs to stand up to 5 uses just so that you can, you know, kind of do proof of concept. So you're going to now try to 3D print those threads. Well, how are you going to model out those threads? So I want to thank you all very much, as always, for tuning in to Toby's Tech Talk. If you do have any questions, you can fire those questions in over on the right. I'm happy to answer any questions you might have. I'll answer them online here, or I'll follow up with you afterwards. And again, thank you. You can also email us, swtech@prismeng.com. It's always good seeing everybody. And of course, you know, tune in next month, tune in every month. All right, Chad, good one. Chad said, I've got a bolt. All right, get it? That's your pun. I like it. All right. But thank you guys very much. And I'll continue answering the questions. But for now, the webinar is concluded. And feel free to enjoy the rest of your Wednesday. And I hope you guys are all enjoying the new year as well. All right. Take care. Bye-bye.